Good evening, everyone. Good to see you all again. Please, can we get ready? If you're outside, please come in. Are we good to go? Praise the Lord. So God is going to do something wonderful for us tonight. Amen? So let me start with a very interesting story. Something that happened to me maybe 6 or 8 years ago. And I was waiting to preach a sermon. So I was asking God what I was going to preach. And he said, I should preach the sermon, Come Down from the Cross. So I began to research the sermon, Come Down from the Cross. And boy, how many times have I come down from the cross? As I researched it out, and the day I began to preach it, I was literally shedding tears, crying and preaching the sermon, Come Down from the Cross. You see, come down from the cross is a voice of Satan, the voice of our detractors that want to bring us to a place where we become what? Vulnerable. So that we can become what? Their victims. I want to say that again. Coming down from the cross, or come down from the cross, is the voice of what? Satan, our detractors, to bring us to the place where we become what? Vulnerable and become what? Victims. So how many of us have become vulnerable, harassed, tormented, because what? We're in a vulnerable position. How many of us have been abused because what? We have become what? Vulnerable. So it's because we came down from the cross. If Jesus Christ had come down from the cross, where would we be today? So when I realized how many times I've come down from the cross, I began to weep. My weeping was not for others, it's for me. Because I've come down from the cross too many a time. And then you start wondering why your prayers are not answered. You start wondering why. The why is because we are not in the place of safety. That's the reason why. Now, many of us are crying out for deliverance. We get delivered and then the cycle begins again. We become what? Victims again. We get delivered, we become victims again, and the cycle continues. Why? That's what I want to address tonight. Why we are not delivered. Why, let me put it this way. Do we know that there's a cycle of rain? How rain comes. Amen? Now, let me tell you about the cycle of rain. And when the Bible tells us that out of your belly shall flow what? Rivers of living waters. Now, what is the purpose of the rivers of living waters? The purpose of the rivers of living water is this. It's not for your own sake. The purpose of what the river is for somebody else to drink from it. Amen? It's for somebody else to bathe in it. It's for somebody else to fish in it. It's for somebody else to water their plants with it and produce fruits. Amen? Now, if a river is flowing out of me, and you drink from that river, and you've been in a dry and thirsty land, will you not rejoice for me? Will you not give thanks to God on my behalf? That God has used this man to give me what? Water to drink. Now, when you drink from my river, as some of you are going to drink tonight, from my anointing, amen? When you drink from this anointing, you go home saved, healed, delivered. You are going to rejoice. You're going to be glad that you came tonight, amen? You are going to rejoice that God used me to touch your lives. Now, this your rejoicing, this your giving thanks to God becomes what? Vapor. Your praise and worship for what God has done for you becomes what? A vapor that what? Rises up. Amen? You know, when if there's going to be rain, there has to be what? First of all, vapor that rises up. And as the vapor increases, it becomes what? A cloud. Is that right? And as the cloud gathers more and more, then it becomes thick clouds. And then they begin to jostle one against the other. There'll be lightning and there'll be what? Thunderings. Amen? And then it will begin to what? Rain. Is that right? Now, the earth drinks the rain. The anointing falls fresh on you again because what? People have been drinking from your river. Amen? And then so there's another what? Outflow again from your life because you're drinking from the rain of heaven, from the anointing of God, and then the river flows through you to bless people again. And then the cycle what? Continues. But if it comes to a time whereby you are not giving out anymore, that means there'll be less praise, less thanksgiving on your behalf unto God. So there'll be some little vapor, but the vapor, they are not strong enough to make clouds, or even they make some clouds. The clouds are not many, and so they don't what? Form rain. So what happens? The cycle has been what? Broken. So many of us have broken cycles in our lives. And that's why there's no rain. That's why we're in a dry and what? Thirsty land. But God wants to turn things around for us today. You see, the things that the word of God will do, we want to use deliverance instead. You want somebody to come and knock the devil on the head to run away from you. And all you needed to do is to receive instructions and to do the word of God. The Bible says you shall know what? Help me, somebody. You shall know what? The truth. And the truth shall what? Set you free. So the knowledge of the situation you are in, the knowledge of the solution to your problem will what? Put you above. Amen? Will what? Put you above. So many don't want to spend time in reading the word. Even if I preach a wonderful sermon, you go and say, oh, what a wonderful sermon. That's all to it. It goes into what? The air. It vaporizes of no value to you. But when it really touches your life, you go back and say, you know one thing? I want to be a good student. I didn't waste my time driving to church just for entertainment. I want reality. I want a change. I want transformation in my life. And so I go back and study everything that he has said. I've taken notes. I go back to review it so that tomorrow, if I have to share this word with somebody else, I can even do better than what he did. Yeah. Amen? So that is the way that we know the truth. We come to the knowledge of the truth, and the truth sets us what? Free. Now, if God says, do not put your hand in the electric socket. That's what the word of God says. You want verse for it? So don't put your hand in the electric socket. How many of you mothers here have tried to block electric sockets so that your children don't dip something into it? You make such efforts. Is that right? But why is it that we adults, we do it? God says, don't put your hands there, and we do it. And then we get hurt and start wondering, oh, why is he being mean to me? Now, let me tell you a very interesting thing about Saul. Saul was against the people of God. Now, when that vision came to him, the light as bright as the noonday sun, and he was struck down. And he said, Paul, Paul, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? He said, who art thou, Lord? And then Jesus Christ said to him, it's hard for thee to kick against what? The pricks. Now, look at, let me give you an example of what a prick is. Look at a Roman chariot. They put, there are some spikes that come out of it so that when another chariot or a horse is coming close to them, the horse leg will be cut off. So they are trying to prevent horsemen from getting too close to the chariot. Now, you imagine such metal pricks, you are kicking against it with your leg. Come on! What's going to happen to you? You're going to hurt yourself. You're going to start bleeding, break your bones. So how stupid is it for us to kick against the pricks? God said to Saul, say, you are fighting a losing battle. You cannot kick against me and win. You cannot kick against the headstone and you will not be broken. And if it is the headstone, if the stone falls upon you, it will grind you to what? Powder. Now, on whose side are you really? You see, an unknown author wrote this. He said, many Christians claim to love God, but do not do his biddings. But they claim to hate the devil, but what? They obey the devil. The devil says, look at that beautiful woman. You look at that beautiful one. Or you lust after her, and one thing leads to another. Yet you know the Bible says, you know, if you look at a woman to lust after her, you've committed what? Adultery in your heart. But you look a second too long and you get yourself into trouble. So immediately you see one beautiful woman, say, in Jesus' name. And turn your face away. Hallelujah. Amen. It's better to get out of trouble than to look 1 second longer and get yourself into big time trouble. So we find out that we are hurting ourselves because the Bible says, my people perish for what? Lack of knowledge. So the knowledge of the truth, the knowledge of what God has told you to do, will keep you from what? Every evil. It does not mean you will not suffer persecution. Persecution is not what God says it will prevent you from. But if sin, being a slave to sin, is what God is saying, that you'll be free from sin. So sin will not what? Have dominion over you. That means sin will not what? Be king, rule over your life. So we need to deal with these things. And I want to tell you one plain truth. If you think you are in trouble right now, it's just the tip of the iceberg. You've never seen trouble yet. Big time trouble is what? Coming. You know why I know? I'll tell you. Some of your popular television stars, Christian television stars, your superstars, super pastors, mega pastors, do you know where they're heading to? They're heading to Rome. Some of them have embraced the Pope. They've kissed his ring. And the Bible says, whosoever you subject yourself to, his servants you what? Are. By the time it gets too late, they see that the mark of the beast is staring them in the face. So they will either pay with their lives or take the mark. But the thing is this, because they are your standard, many people have made preachers their standard. And so they follow the blind preachers. They might be multimillionaires. They might have jets, but they are blind. If the blind lead the what? Blind, they'll both fall into the ditch. Or somebody will say, who do you think you are? No, who even knows you as a preacher? It doesn't matter. I have the word of God as my standard, and no man of God is my standard. Now, for so many years, okay, let me go back way back to 1979. June 8th of 1979 was when I had a visitation from God, and God delivered me from Catholicism. And I said goodbye to Christmas and Easter forever. But I was shocked. Remember, I was a charismatic Catholic. I came among the Pentecostals. I saw that they had these idols also. Yeah, they didn't have the physical idols like we had in the Catholic Church. But they were serving Baal. They were serving Ishtar. They were saying, Happy Ishtar. Do you know if you came, if you meet an Easterner, somebody from the Middle East, who know what Easter is, and you say, Happy Easter, they will wonder, say, does this guy know what he's talking about? Easter is the bare-breasted goddess of fertility. In my home, in my place, she's called Olokun, that's the goddess of the river. So when we talk about marine spirit, she is behind it all. Hallelujah. So now we have Pentecostals, everybody else doing the same thing, Christmas, no, and all the rest of it. And then one day I was discussing with my wife, and she said that this anointed man is celebrating it. This anointed man is celebrating it. I told her this. I said, the Bible says that every man in his own order. Hallelujah. Christ the first fruits, and they that are Christ at his coming. And the Bible says there's the glory of the moon, and there's the glory of what? The sun. And one star differed from another star in glory. So also is what? The resurrection. We are loved with the same love of God, but it's our consecration that will make the difference in our lives. Whether you are going to take the front row seat in heaven, whether you are going to sit on the throne with God. Do you know there are those who are destined for the throne of God? Have you seen the vision of heaven given by John in the book of Revelation? It talks about the throne, is that right? Then it talks about the 24 elders. Then it talks about those who are just in the front of the throne area there, and then the millions upon millions that cannot be numbered. So if you want to take the last row seat, that's cool. That's the choice we've made. But I don't want to take the last row seat. I don't even want the front row seat. I want to sit on the throne. Because God says he has destined us for the throne. And that's what I'm what? Going to shoot for, nothing less. Amen. That's what God is calling every one of us to. So this wishy-washy so-called Christianity is a waste of your time and it's a waste of God's time. You are neither hot, you are neither cold. And God said, because you are lukewarm, I will spew you out of what? My mouth. That was the state Virginia state was in. They were neither for the Union Army or for the Confederate. The word wishy-washy, and Virginia got burnt down. Hallelujah. Amen? So when you straddle the fence in Christianity, you are in very grievous danger. Because you are neither for God, you are neither for the devil. So if you are for the world, go ahead and have all the fun. Get drunk. Have all the women or men that you want. Do everything and have fun, because tomorrow you die. That's being in the world. But when you say, oh, I struggle into Christianity, I try to pray, but I want to have a little fun, you are not having what? Both worlds. Now, if you belong to God, then God's security agents are for you. They are with you. Amen? So you have the protection and you have the full benefit of heaven on your side. But we neither have this, neither are we enjoying the world in full. So we are to be most pitied of all men. And that's the way many Christians have lived their lives and are still living their lives, and they are wondering why me. You see, unless we concentrate ourselves, unless what? We concentrate ourselves unto God. The Bible says, except we become what? Living sacrifices, wholly devoted unto God, which is our reasonable service. The Bible says, love not the world, nor the things that are what? In the world. Amen? Now, when we love the world, then the love of the Father is not in us. So, if we love the world, the world should take care of you. The world should take care of its own. So, why do you come to church and look for help when you love the world? Yes, if you come for help because you want to consecrate your life unto God, you are welcome. That's what we're looking for. Amen? And then we can show you the way, point you to the way. Jesus Christ is the way. He is the healer. He is everything to you. Remember, whosoever you obey, whether of sin unto death or of righteousness unto holiness unto God, then his servant ye are. Amen? So if you serve sin, then you are a servant of sin. Sin is your Lord and Master. Satan is your master. But when you love righteousness, then you are declaring that Jesus Christ, you are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus, and he is your God, he is your master, he is your Lord. So who is your Lord and who is your master? You know. I want to tell you this. Very soon, the great revival that we've been waiting for in Arizona is going to come on the scene. That's the only reason why I came to Arizona. I came to America. I had no reason to come to America. And you wonder, hey, I thought you were living on trees. Yeah, it's better on the tree that you jump from tree to tree. That's fun. Really, there's no need for me to come here. I have no reason whatsoever. But I only came because I have an assignment. And the revival will soon be in the air. And I want you to know this. You see, last Sunday was what they call the Feast of, Rosh Hashanah. How many of you heard of that? You see, religion is so dangerous. And please run away from religion. Do you know what Rosh Hashanah has done? And everybody is shouting, Rosh Hashanah, Rosh Hashanah. It has eclipsed the truth of the Feast of Trumpets. The Feast of Trumpets is the day and hour that no man knows. That will come upon us suddenly. And then if you are filthy, you remain filthy still. Hallelujah. If you are righteous, you remain righteous still. If there are two in the field, one will be taken away and the other one will be left. Now, the one that is taken away is one that is destroyed or dies, not the Christian. I know people have a lot of funny preaching or teaching on these things. In the days of Noah, who were taken away? It was the wicked that were destroyed, not the righteous. But that is the core of what? Of the Feast of Trumpets. But instead, all over the place, you are hearing Rosh Hashanah, Rosh Hashanah. Even Christians are saying Rosh Hashanah. What are they talking about? Oh, the beginning of the new year. Oh, happy new year. That's what they are saying. When the depth of it is that, the Feast of Trumpets, when God is going to show up you see, the Feast of Trumpets originally happened in Pentecost. But God said, move it from Pentecost celebration and move it to what? As part of the Feast of Tabernacles. Because the trumpet is what sounds an alarm about a war coming or for the camp to move. So when the cloud of glory is moving, you sound the trumpet and then you move with the cloud. But if you do not move with the cloud, then you stay behind, you're going to be in trouble. Because the cloud of glory is your protection. The Bible said the cloud shall be for what? A defense. Amen? The cloud protects you from the sun, from the blazing desert sun. It becomes an umbrella to you. Hallelujah. Amen? That's what the glory will do for you. At night, when it's desert cold, the fire becomes what? A warmth to you. That's what God wants to do for us, to lead us in the way. But we say we don't want to go within. And the Bible says there's a way that seems right unto a man, but the end is what? Destruction. So some of us are listening to these sweet mouth preachers. Preachers that have money in their mouth. They will make you sell your clothes. Thank God for what Brother Mike is doing here. Nobody brings the offering plate and knocking on your door. Hey, you have money to give? Who will give $100? Who will give $1,000? We don't do that here. Thank God Benny Hinn just repented about it. Hallelujah. So if Benny Hinn was our standard, then we'll continue what? Hey, $1,000, $10,000, and the rest of it. Is that right? So no man can be your standard. So when my wife was saying this, recently, one of my favorite preachers, his name is Sadhu Sundar Selvaraj. He too was celebrating Christmas. I said, well, he's an anointed man of God. Someday he will learn. But you know, just this year, he came up and said, about 2 years ago, God spoke to him and he stopped doing such garbage in his ministry. Hallelujah. So what I'm saying, the anointing is not the reason why a man should be what? Your standard. Hallelujah. Amen? The word of God must be what? Your standard. So as small as I am, the best thing I can rely upon is the infallible word of God. Not any man of God as my standard. Amen? Like I've said many times, every man of God should be what? Like a stepping stone for you. Learn from them and move forward because you can be better than them. Amen? I say you can be better than any man of God. The man of God is supposed to be what? Your coach. Is that right? But for me, I'm a coach player. Hallelujah. I love being what? A coach and a player. You know why? I explain to you. Now in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11, the Bible says that God gave us what? Apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers for what? The equipping of the saints for the work of the ministry. Is that correct? Then it goes on to say, till we all come together, that means the coaches and what? The players, till we all come together in the unity of faith and of the knowledge of what? The Son of God. Amen? And then we move on to what? To the stature of the perfect man. Hallelujah. I want to get to the stature of the perfect man. I don't want to just be an apostle. Being an apostle, prophet is good, but it's nothing compared to being a son of God. Hallelujah. And God is calling every one of us. Every one of us. That is the goal of God, is to bring us what? Into the image of Jesus Christ. So that he might be what? The firstborn among many brethren who are just like him. So that's the goal of Christianity. So why are you born again? Why do you come to church? To die and go to heaven? I love what one minister of God said. He said, if that's the purpose of going to heaven, you get born again, go to heaven, then you only need two ministries. The first ministry is what? An evangelist. And the second ministry is what? An assassin. So you get born again, an assassin puts a bullet in your head, you get to heaven. Is that not simple? So why are you on the earth? What is God's purpose for you on the earth? So what purpose are you fulfilling? So we find out that if we have no purpose, when we talk about consecration is what? Being dedicated to what? A purpose. Amen? So to what purpose are you committed to? What are you dedicated to? What have you been what? Separated unto? What are you wholly devoted to? That's a big question. So what does Christianity mean to you? Who is Jesus to you? You visit him on Sunday? And maybe midweek service or on a Friday like tonight? And then you go home back, maybe you get out of here and head for the club. So who are we deceiving? What's the whole purpose of all the hypocrisy in our lives? Now, if we take an x-ray of our lives, x-ray, and what? Put it there on the board. How many of you will want us to play your movie on the board? How many of you? No, let's be sincere. Do you want me to play your movie there? Your secret scenes? The words you spoke yesterday night? Your texting and everything else? Now, these are the things that what make us what? Vulnerable. Amen? We have what? Become victims of the devil. We think it's fun. But what it's actually doing is that we are in a place of great vulnerability, and the devil takes advantage of us, and we become what? Victims. A day will come, and very shortly too, that those who sit down in the church and claim to be Christians, God is giving us what? A very long rope to repent now. Because a day will come, the video will play, literally. An address where you went to, who you texted yesterday, who you paid $100 for sex yesterday, everything will show up there. Now, God is not doing that because he wants to disgrace you. It's because he has given you opportunity to repent, but you refused. But he said, I don't want you to perish. So I want you to bring you to a place where you have no choice but to get on your knees and say, God, I did it. I'm sorry. Have mercy upon me. And it's not for any one of us to condemn you, but to say, finally, our brother, our sister has been what? Delivered from the clutches of Satan. And now God can use you. The man that God will use. The man that God uses. God wants to be glorified in and through every one of us here. But secret sins. Coming down from the cross. Has defiled us. There's so much defilement in our lives. So for those who are what? Consecrated unto God. They are wholly devoted to God. Then there's nothing profane in their lives. The Bible says, shun profane things, shun profane babblings, shun all these things that do not what? Glorify God. Because of these things, the judgment of God comes upon the world. So if God is going to judge the world because of fornication, and you are in the church, you are fornicating, don't you think you'll be judged also? If God is going to judge backbiting and everything else that are contrary to the nature of God, don't you think you'll be judged also? Because we do the same things in the church. But I want to tell you that tonight, grace will come. The grace of God that what? Will help us to be overcomers. So many of us are where we are today because of sin. Some of us is because of unforgiveness. Unforgiveness has crippled some people. Yes, you were vulnerable yesterday. You say you are not a Christian, but there are doors in your heart, there are windows you don't ever want anybody to open. And as long as those windows are closed, the doors are locked up, it's a padded cell, or what do they call it? A death row cell, or whatever they call it. So you put yourself on death row on your own. You are in captivity. now is so painful that a lot of Christians are using sedatives and things that help you, psych meds. They are using it. But God wants to be glorified above the pharmaceuticals. Hallelujah. God is bigger than the pharmaceuticals. I want to believe that one of the reasons that Jesus Christ was persecuted would be this. A doctor who has a patient for 12 whole years and gets money from this patient, suddenly the patient does not show up again. Why? Oh, the man Jesus healed her. Oh, another one, cancer patient. So many cancer patients, they don't show up in hospital anymore. Why? Because the man Jesus Christ, what, healed them. Very soon it's going to happen. We empty the hospitals. Nurses will begin to say, hey, I'm not jobless. Doctors say, hey, we don't have patients anymore. It's those people who say they are Christians, believers. Let's throw them in jail. Let's feed them to the lions. But I want you to know that if you truly put your absolute trust in God, the glory of God will be your defense. The Bible says that God will look through the pillar of fire again. Like when the children of when the Egyptians were coming against the children of Israel. We are told that God looked through what? The pillar of fire and troubled the Egyptians. Hallelujah. I said, those things that trouble you, the people that trouble you, God will trouble them. Hallelujah. I said, God will trouble. Hallelujah. And trouble will be in what? Trouble. Because God has what? Troubled. Hallelujah. Amen. So that's why we must have confidence in God. That's why we must be consecrated unto God. That's why we must be sanctified. You don't hear the word sanctification anymore. In the early 1800s, or during the time of John Wesley, you know, that's the holiness movement. They spoke about sanctification, the second work of grace. Being born again is the first work of grace. Sanctification, the second work of grace. And baptism of the Holy Ghost is the third work of grace. Do you want me to meddle a little bit? No, I won't meddle tonight. But do you know if they were the holiness movement, hallelujah, amen, then women dress appropriately. I'm not meddling, I'm just saying something. Now today, women dress to kill. Lord have mercy. That's why you men don't look. In Jesus' name, and you'll be free. The Bible tells us they are going to have tingling feet. No, cha 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 cha, tingling feet. And then they wear bracelets in their legs making noises. Is that right? Is there in the Bible? I never wrote the Bible. I'm just saying what the Bible says. So we must stay away from every form of evil. Now, the word sanctify means this. It says to stay away or to be removed from that which is common and unclean. Everybody does it. Others may, but I cannot. Amen? That should be our motto as a Christian. Others may, but I cannot. Others may drink booze and go to clubhouses and dance away their lives and everything, but as a Christian, I cannot. Others might go to the casino and gamble away their lives, their living and everything else, but as a Christian, I cannot because my hands are holy. My hands are sanctified. You see, a young man was in a train. I think it was a Chinese man. He was in a train, and there were three other people on the train with him. And they wanted to play a game of cards. And they needed four people for that game of cards. And they asked if he could join them. He said, sorry, I did not bring my hands with me. And they looked at him strange. What do you mean you didn't bring my hands? He said, these hands are not mine. They belong to Jesus. So if my lips belong to Jesus, then I cannot be kissing some strange woman. Amen? If my legs belong to Jesus, I cannot be walking to some strange places, sneaking around. Amen? So if my mouth belongs to Jesus or my thoughts belong to Jesus, they must be sanctified. So what we are saying and what we want to go get into is a place of total consecration. Say, take my life, let it be consecrated unto you. Take my hands, let my hands only do the things that will please you. Let my hands not go to any secret place. Amen? Let my eyes not behold evil, sanctify my eyes. So that when that tingling woman goes around, I say, in Jesus' name, my eyes are sanctified. I'll see no evil, I'll hear no evil. Because I don't want to come down from the cross. See, there's one man of God. He did deliverance quite a lot. He didn't say exactly what happened. He said, they got me. They got me. So maybe he fell into a sexual sin. And the devil said, hey, this is your last. And he never came out of it. He died. He became sick and died. And all he said, they got me. They got me. So I don't want you to be got by anything. Because, oh, you've terrorized the devil, and now, in just one split second of what? Wrong stuff. You came down from the cross, and the devil said, for the last time. For the last time. I don't know if you have opportunity like Samson that said, one more time, Lord. One more time, Lord. It took a Delilah, shaved his head, he became vulnerable. This man, before anything happens, it doesn't matter how many men came against him. He will carry the gate of a city to the top of a hill. I mean, it's like carrying a semi-truck. One man carrying a semi-truck and taking it on top of the hill. That was Samson. Until he came down from the cross. And they began to afflict him. But he still had an opportunity and he cried, one more time, Lord. One more time, Lord. But will you have that one more time? Because in the day and hour that no man knows, it happens. So I want you to be committed unto God. You see, grace, okay, I didn't finish defining sanctification. The word sanctify is to be separated from that which is what? Common and what? Unclean. Before you did a lot of unclean things, you know, you lived unclean lives and everything. But God says, I want to what? Sanctify you and bring you out of that which is common and unclean. And then what I'm going to do, I'm going to clothe you with the nature of God. That's what the word sanctify is, means. So we see that the grace is available for us to be clothed with what? Righteousness. So it's the work of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will what? Clothe us. We become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. He's made unto us what? Sanctification. He is our sanctifier. He is our baptizer. He is the one that has removed us from that which is common and unclean and put on us his very nature. So that one we must depend upon. Your struggle against sin, no, your failing is because what you are struggling in your own power, in your own strength, in your own ability. You say, oh, I will not do it. Maybe 6 months goes by. You are okay. Then the 7 months, you sleep. You know, you are in a roller coaster again. But the Holy Ghost, the neglected one. The Holy Ghost is what? The neglected one in the church. Just like your Sunday Bible, you know, you pick up your Bible on Sundays. You pick up the Holy Ghost on Sundays. And then when you get back home, you dump him. You have no use for him. But do you know he has inside information? Amen? The Holy Ghost has what? Inside information. He tells you, somebody is setting a trap for you at work. Oh, let me give you a very interesting one. And I'm sure he did speak to some people on 9/11. The Holy Ghost said, don't go to work today. He said, oh God, you see, we have a special meeting. The president is coming at 8 o'clock. God says, don't go to work. Oh, the voice of God has become what? Irrelevant. It becomes, you know, your boss. What's all meeting you, that you have becomes what more important than what God is saying. And so many went. Did the meeting still hold? No. If the boss was there, if the CEO was there, whatever it is, he must have died also. The meeting did not see the light of day. So when are we going to begin to hear the voice of God? Because that's the Christianity 101. My sheep, they what? Hear my voice. So if you do not hear the voice of God, then you are a bastard and not a child of God. It's a hard word to say. But that's the simplest thing that anybody should hear, is to hear the voice of the Father. So are you truly born again? Are you truly a Christian? Are you truly a sheep of God? And do you hear his voice? So his voice, you know, by his voice, we are what? Instructed. We are directed. And the Holy Ghost is your personal guide. He's there, your personal instructor. Can you imagine? The God of heaven is your personal what? Instructor. 24/7. Even the people you hire, they go home to sleep. They give you probably 8 hours. But the Holy Ghost says, I will never leave you nor what? Forsake you. So why are we not taking advantage of the great God that lives in us, that wants to speak to us, that wants to lead us, that wants to guide us? Now, what surprised me is this. The glory of the Lord led the people out of Egypt. Is that right? The pillar of cloud by day, the pillar of fire by night. Do you know, even in this situation, some people said they want to go back to Egypt? Why is it that even in, you see, the reason is that there's leaven in Pentecost. I want you to understand that. There's what? Leaven in Pentecost. In the feast of Passover, you use unleavened bread. In the Feast of Pentecost, you use leavened bread. But in the Feast of Tabernacles, you use what? Unleavened bread. Why? God is saying in this Pentecostal era, there will be leavens. Your favorite pastor will carry leaven. But you should use the sending of spirits to know what, you know, the Bible says, proving all things and holding to that which is what? True. Some will preach Christ out of contention. Some will preach Christ because of money. Many of them are preaching Christ because of money and different things. They are still doing the work of God. Amen? But at the end of the day, they get their reward. But yours is this, to discern what they are saying, whether it's according to the standard or not. if it's not rejected. Does no matter how many dead he raised, that's not the criteria. It does not matter how many dead they are and they own airplanes. No, the word of God is your standard. And like I said, you can be better than them. Amen? I'm not worried about any of them. None of them intimidate me because I know who I am. I know my goal. And the Bible says, you know, Jesus Christ said to Peter, come walk on the water. God is saying to you too today, come walk on the water. So if God says you should come walk on the water, if God says you can be like him, then why do you want to become like any of those playboy preachers? Why? They are not your standard. Jesus is your standard. And tonight, we must come to the place of consecration. Paul said, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. The life I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God. So he came to the place of death. I think it would be a wonderful time to preach our funeral service. Amen? A funeral service is when somebody dies and we preach about the dead man. Is that right? How many of us want me to preach our funeral service right now? How many of us are ready to die? Because except we die, we cannot live. The Bible says, except a grain of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains alone. But when you are willing to give all to the master, Paul said, whether I live or die, I belong to God. So we must come to that place. I am a living sacrifice. I'm wholly devoted to God. I'm dedicated to the word of God. I'm a student of the word. I spend time in the word of God. I eat the word of God for breakfast, for lunch, for dinner. I sleep with the word of God. Many of you sleep with women, amen. But there are those who will sleep with the word of God, hallelujah. Amen. They will cuddle him, they love him. They hear the voice of the master. So will you hear his voice tonight? He wants to help you. He does not want the roller coaster in your life. He does not want... No, I want to ask you this question. The Bible says in Ephesians chapter 1, I believe verse 20, it says, far above principalities and powers. Everybody say, far above. Far above principalities and powers. Now, Satan, principalities and powers, they are like the generals in the army, in the devil's army. You are far above them. But now, you are struggling with a little demon. A recruit, a new recruit, a three-year-old witch is harassing you. A private is harassing you. A corporal is harassing you. When you are what? Far above their generals. That's a ridiculous place to be in. So it's not just that the Bible says you are far above them, but you must know it. Hallelujah. Not the theory of the word, but the practice of the word. Father, Lord, you said, I'm far above principalities and powers, rulers of darkness of this world, far above dominions. That's who you are. Not to be kicked around by some little demons. Oh, there's a demon in my head. Ah, demon in my head. Come out! When you are far above that demon, do you realize that? Once you realize your authority, the devil knows that you know that he knows that he has to what? Get out. Life will be easy for you tonight because you shall know the truth and the truth will set you free. You see, You can, you, Many have built homes on what? On sand. And it takes very little flood. Somebody sent me a text. I saw a two-story building crash to the ground. It was videotaped on the phone. Crashed to the ground because there was flood. The flood was about knee deep. So it affected the foundation and everything came what? Crumbling down. So are you building your foundation on sand? Or are you willing to take the time to dig and dig and dig until you get to the solid rock and what? Build upon that foundation. My anointing will not build the foundation for you. I'm being frank with you. So when you are depending on somebody's anointing, you see, my anointing is to get you to a place where, you know, you have a breathing space to dig your foundation and what? Be planted. But if I release the anointing and everything, you have that space of time and then you do nothing with it. You become what? Vulnerable again. The cycle continues. I hope we understand what we're talking about here. So I cannot help you dig the foundation. You have to dig the foundation for yourself. I can give you the tools, provide the grace for you to do it, but you got to do it, nobody else. And build your house. Foundation. And you know that the depth of your foundation will determine the height of your superstructure. So if you want to build a bungalow, that's just fine for you. You can live in a bungalow in heaven. But there are those that says, no, I want to build what? A skyscraper. So for me to build a skyscraper, I'm going to dig about 100 feet down in the earth. Hallelujah. I'm going to build upon that solid rock that cannot be moved. Hallelujah. You've heard about the rock of Gibraltar. Say, immovable like the rock of Gibraltar. So we have to be planted. Those that be planted in the house of our God shall flourish in the courts of our God. So why are you not flourishing? Because you are not planted. You are wishy-washy. You are a potted plant. Today you jump to this church, to that church and everything. Yet God wants to give you direction. Say, there's a place you have to go to. Some churches need to be emptied. I'm being frank with you. Some churches need to stop existence. And I pray it happens in Jesus' name. Because they are wasting people's lives, wasting people's time. They need to close up. But remember, some of us here are victims in such churches. They tingle your ears. You cool with it. They make you laugh. You cool. Oh, funny, Pastor. Funny, you are laughing to hell. You see, you need to take responsibility by knowing the truth. And the Holy Ghost wants to help you. Thank you, Jesus. Shall we rise? Say with me, Father, Lord, I come as I am. I lay my life at your feet. I lay my all at your feet. Be my Lord and Master. My thoughts I give to you. Sanctify my thoughts. My imaginations I give to you. Sanctify my imaginations. My mouth I surrender to you. My tongue I surrender to you. Begin to lead me in what I say, in what I do. My hands are offered unto you. Let the works of my hands be pleasing unto you. My feet I give to you. Direct me where to go. In the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ. My sexuality I give unto you. Let me not defile this temple. In the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ. My ears I give unto you. Let it be sanctified. Let it be ready to hear your voice. It will not hear the voice of the enemy. In the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus, wash me. Purge me. Purge me. Cleanse me from every unrighteousness. From every iniquities. The iniquities of my father's house. The iniquities of my mother's house. This day, by the hammer of God, I break in pieces every idol in my life, in my family, in my ancestral homes. I break every such idols in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus, it is written, he who the Son sets free is free indeed. I declare my freedom from sin, sickness, Satan, and diseases in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, Lord, great is your faithfulness. Your word is true. Sanctify me with your word. Let me be to the praise and glory of your holy name. In the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Abba Father. Holy Spirit, I welcome you. Come and have the right of way. In the name of Jesus Christ. Lead me and guide me. Let me hear that still small voice. In the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Abba Father. In Jesus' name. Amen. Now I want you to know that the Master is here. He is healer, savior, deliverer. He's your all in all. And he's giving you this opportunity tonight to go dig and lay your foundation properly. Amen. I say it's giving you what opportunity tonight. That when you go home, this is not another service whereby you can go back and then the cycle not continues. No. Stop it today. Kill it today. Amen. Whether that rat that comes to your house, that cockroach, you know, call the Orkin man. Kill it today. Kill it today. The opportunity is for you to go back home and get to the word and lay your foundation. And once you do that, those things will not come again. They won't come again. Those voices will not come again. Those bands over your head, broken. Tonight, because God is a faithful God. He says, in my name, you shall cast out demons. It's simple as that. You shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall what? Recover. Did he say, I shall shout 10 times, dance James Brown or whatever it is, and then the demons will go? No. All those gyrations don't do nothing. Amen? I used to dance James Brown in those days. Don't do nothing. Those noise making, don't do nothing. It's the simplicity of the word of God. Because God is faithful. Amen? God is able. Is he able? Then trust him tonight. that as the workers come and pray with you, no matter what your situation is, it doesn't matter. It doesn't have to be me who lays hands upon you. They are believers. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. And once you get this space that God is giving to you, go and dig down. The New Testament is there. Begin to read, read. Be saturated with the Word of God. And you see that you are... Have you seen flies go to a hot barbecue stove? Will they do that? Even the demons are not foolish enough to do that. The flies don't do it. Demons are not foolish enough to go to a hot Christian who is on fire. No, they don't. It's when you have cooled down and the smell of that bacon and all those things, then they get attracted to you. When you have those trash in your homes, one thing I've learned is not to leave trash for too long in my garage. Because there was a time we have to be dealing with flies almost every time. When you open the garage door, you know, they're inside. So my wife said, no, we don't do that anymore. So I tried to take the trash out every day. And since then, we don't have to deal with flies anymore. Amen? So if you take out the trash in your life, no demon will come near you. So if you want the touch of God, if you want to be healed and delivered once and for all, amen? Amen. Then step out. The workers are here. We pray with you. Thank you, Jesus. Remember, you must be what? Consecrated. Giving all to the Master. Never again. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Woman, step forward. Hello, woman, step forward. Pasha Katarubash. Parokotorubash. The burden of guilt upon you. You see, sorrow is a clean wound. But guilt is an unclean wound. It festers and punishes you. But today, Jesus has come to remove the guilt and the shame. Lift up your hands. Where are the workers, please? Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Holy Ghost, I receive freedom. Say, I receive freedom.
I receive freedom.
Right now.
Right now.
Right now.
Right now.
Satan.
Satan.
Take your filthy hands off me.
Take your filthy hands off me.
Now.
Now.
Be free.
Be free.
No, you be free. Keep quiet right now. Every planting of the enemy comes out. Go ahead and begin to pray for them, please. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost.
Holy Ghost.
Just receive now. I command the burden to go. Go. The burden and shoulder to go. Every planting of the enemy to leave you right now. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I decree total freedom. Jesus Christ sets you free. Now. Now. Every planting of the enemy comes out. Now. As we lay hands upon you, we are dedicating you, consecrating you to the Master, that you belong to the Master, that you no longer belong to the devil. You belong to the Master. Hallelujah. Amen.
Amen.
So in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I consecrate you to the Master. Spirit, soul, and body. Jesus, be glorified in this life. Breathe in deeply and out. Out. In the name of Jesus. Tell me what's happening to you right now. Tell me. Talk to me.
Just adultery. Drugs. Graphics. Molestation. Rape.
It's all gone. I've spoken to you to go.
But
stress, go.
Please don't talk to me.
Go. Just receive the peace of God right now. Say, peace of God, I receive you right now. And I'm free. Free from every work of the enemy. Declare your freedom. I begin to speak. I begin to declare your freedom. How are you? What do you want Jesus to do for you?
I don't know. I just have been going through hell. I've been homeless off and on. I have a sleep disorder. There's just so many things I have to do. I mean, I don't want to be homeless anymore. I'm starting a new job tomorrow. I finally got out of the homeless shelter yesterday and got a small place. So I don't know what God is telling me that, you know, I don't know. I just need help because my life has been a roller coaster. Jump off the roller coaster. I've been on up and down, here and there.
So are you ready to dig down to the foundation? That's the choice. No, that's the only choice. There's no way. You have to get into the Word of God for yourself.
I've been in the Word and reading, and, you know, I don't know what exactly means to dig down.
Well, to dig down is from now. You hear and do the Word. It's not just the theory of the Word, but acting on the Word, doing the Word of God. That grace I will release upon you, and the curse of homelessness, of the roller coaster, I'm going to destroy that curse in your life right now in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Holy Ghost, you became poor that she might become rich. The curse, the roller coaster in her life, I destroy it right now in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Holy Ghost, Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost, Holy Ghost, every foul demon, every foul spirit, hear ye my voice, come out of her right now in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. You demon of poverty, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I curse you right now. I say, loose her, let her go. Loose her, let her go in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. From this day forward, she begins to prosper. From this day forward, she begins to prosper. From this day forward, her ears are open to hear your voice, to understand your word. Ears be open to hear the voice of God, to follow directions in the name of Jesus Christ. I decree your freedom now in Jesus' name. Be free. Be free. Be free in the name of Jesus Christ. Woman? Oh, you are the one who called me today. Okay. Lift up your hands. Shakaboshe. Parakaboshe. Ole makataraba shalama sakatareboshe. Every planting of the enemy in her house be uprooted in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Every makaboshe ketereba. Every strange things that have come into her house by the fire of God, by the broom of God, has sweep her house clean from every contamination of the enemy. I sweep her house clean, 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 her life clean in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Hola katarababasha kataraboshi. Hola makaparada kabarakada yarababoshi kete. Rekotolo boshi kete. La masha kata. La brotoko boshi kete robasha kata. Oh, every voices that she's hearing, In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Oh, I met her here. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. To begin to hear the voice of the Master. Every voice of the enemy. Every intimidation of the enemy, she will not hear anymore. But she will be bold in the name of the Lord Jesus. For God has not given her the spirit of fear, but of love and of boldness and of a sound mind. I release this unto her right now in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus be glorified in her life in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Father Lord, be a defense to her. Be a defense in her house. That nothing unclean will come into her house in the name of Jesus Christ. And as her night is closed, as her night is closed in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth, we say every planning of the enemy in the life of the son, go, be burned by fire, be burned by fire, be burned by fire, be burned by fire, in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We decree his total deliverance. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I release the anointing of God upon this close of God. That demons will come out of her, of him, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. That sin will no longer have dominion over him, in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Oh, I decree his salvation. I claim his salvation and deliverance, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Thank you, Abba Father, in Jesus' name.